Of the two ferries linking the Isle of Skye to the Scottish mainland, the drive-on, drive-off ferry between Kyloflock Alsh and Kyleakin is the most used. Across the narrow strait, on a 5-minute crossing, the two boats carry throughout the year tourists and residents, cars and caravans, lorries and vans, bringing a vast array of goods from the mainland and Skye's exports off the island. The largest island off the west coast of Scotland, Skye is only 500 metres from the mainland at its closest, just south of the Kyloflock Alsh. Not all travellers to Skye arrive on the car ferries. I expect that most of you go to school on foot or by bus, and that not many of you go to school the way those children do, which is by boat. They've sailed across from the island of Rasay off the northwest coast of Scotland to go to school at Portree, the main town on the island of Skye. They sail across every Monday morning and they don't go home until Friday evening. Children who come from other islands further away only go home at half term and full term. Their destination is Portree High School, one of the largest buildings on the Isle of Skye and one of the newest. The school has primary and secondary sections. This map shows where the boarders came from in 1974. One boatload with seven children came from Harris and nearby Scalpay. Many more sailed from the North East area. Others came from South East, Surrey, Pabay, Rasay, and one from Rum. There were 660 children at the school from Skye itself, plus the 53 from the surrounding islands. Portree is not only a central place for schooling. As the largest settlement in Skye, with a population in 1971 of 1,865, it functions as a centre for the islanders and for holiday visitors, and it provides services for the numerous townships scattered through the island. The largest manufacturing enterprise in Portree is the Skye Woolen Mill. There's been a mill here since 1880. Wool from all over Scotland is spun and woven here. Less than 25% of it comes from Skye, as not all the breeds of sheep here have fine enough wool for some of the products made in this mill. The mill itself provides employment for about 40 people. And in addition, 40 to 50 outworkers, mainly women, do work such as tweed mending and hand knitting. The current owners continue the tradition of making tartan and tweeds. Up to 70,000 visitors come to the mill in the summer, and 50% of the turnover is direct to customer sales. In the winter, the business relies largely on mail orders. This is the town square at Portree. Here we can see the commercial relationship between Portree and the rest of the island. Mobile fish and chip vans are common enough in Britain, but mobile boutiques are less so. In rural areas, there's a mobile bank service, here a van, which makes a regular run to settlements and farms scattered through the island. Boats are used on some other Scottish islands. For large items such as furniture, tools and clothing, the islanders make use of mail order facilities. For their day-to-day grocery needs, the mobile shops are important. The traditional Skye homestead is built on a small holding called a croft, and the crofts are clustered together to form small communities called townships. Frequently, the crofts appear in small, linear settlements strung out along a road or along the line of a bay, like these crofts at Camaster and Veg, 8 kilometres from Portree. A short distance away, at Penyachoran, we can see the traditional single-storey home with stone walls, corrugated metal roof, 2 or 3 living rooms with an extension to house the few animals. The existing buildings contrast sharply with the older black houses with their low roofs of sod and their small size. More numerous than the cattle population is the population of sheep. This farmer has a flock of 300 to 400 sheep. Black-faced is the breed. Now, at the end of June, as the temperatures begin to rise, the sheep are gathered for shearing. Hand methods of shearing are still employed. Another activity associated with farming here is peat cutting. Using a special tool, a peat iron, the farmer cuts slices of peat along a line in his field. The black peat, accumulating often up to 6 metres deep, is composed of organic material. It's the product of decaying heath and moorland vegetation, which solidifies to produce a brownish-black surface layer. The peat is cut and then put in piles as it dries. It's then stored alongside the home where it's burnt in the hearth, or in ovens, producing heat. The townships and crofts exist against a backcloth dominated by the sea on the one hand and mountains and valleys on the other. The Store Mountain, north of Portree, has striking features. Enormous pinnacles of rock stand out against a massive escarpment. Most noticeable of all is the Old Man of Store.
The Old Man of Store. A huge pinnacle of basalt that stands 50 metres high on a base that is 500 metres above sea level. It's a pinnacle which, because of its difficulty, remained unclimbed until 1955 when Don Willans did it. The Old Man of Store is here because of something that happened 60 million years ago. All this area was made up of limestone rocks, and then, 60 million years ago, volcanoes had existed hereabouts, threw out sheet after sheet of lava, millions and millions of tons on it, lying on the limestone. And from then on, it's begun to slip down from the limestone. And the result is that this east coast of Skye presents one of the most spectacular landslip areas in the world.
From the road running by the hydroelectric lochs of Loch Leven and Loch Fada, it's a hard, steep climb up to the Old Man of Store, but it's worth it because, given the right conditions, I think this must be one of the most magnificent views in the world. In the south are the jagged edges of the Black Coolins, then the rounder edges of the Red Coolins. And there, beyond the isles of Rasay and Scalpe, is the mainland with the mountains of Westeros and those spectacular mountains of Sutherland, Sulven, Kerisp, and Stack Polly. Beyond them, to the north, is the extreme tip of Scotland, Cape Roth, and beyond that, nothing but the blue Hebridean Sea. This geology map shows the major rocks found on Skye. Most of the island is composed of igneous rocks. In the northeast, at the Old Man of Stour, limestone, gabbro, and basalt are at the surface. 30 kilometres south are the two mountain ranges called the Coolins and the Red Hills or Red Coolins.
Whether you come to climb them or merely to sit and look at them, there's no doubt that the Coolins of the Isle of Skye are the island's chief attraction. But there are two sorts of Coolins. Behind me to the left are the Black Coolins, and over there to the right are the Red Coolins. There are one or two interesting differences apart from colour. Because if you look at the outline of the Black Coolins, you'll see that they're jagged. They stick up into the sky like broken teeth. Whereas if you look at the Red Coolins, you'll see that they're much rounder, more smooth, more worn down. And the reason they have these two different forms and these two different colours is because of the rock that makes them up. The Black Coolins are made up of this rock. It's called gabbro. It's got big crystals, big grains in it, many of them black, which gives it the colour. And it's very rough, rough on your elbows, rough on your knees, rough on your fingertips when you're climbing, but it does make splendid climbing rock. On the other hand, the Red Coolins are made of this rock, which is called granite. It's related to, but not all that similar to gabbro. And this gets its colour from the big pinky red crystals in it.
The granite is slightly more susceptible to weathering than the gabbro, and that's why the gabbro sticks jaggedly up in the sky. And the granite of the nearby Red Hills presents a rounded appearance. While the Coolins are a major tourist attraction, and the peaks are the objective for the climbers and fell walkers, the lower slopes have commercial importance for the forester. Here, at Glen Brittle Forest, just west of the Coolins, the first trees were planted in 1939. The dominant tree is the Sitka spruce, chosen for its speed of growth. These trees are nearly 40 years old, and having taken all those years to grow, they're now felled in a matter of seconds. Branches are quickly stripped away and the timber cut to length. The logs are winched out of the forest and stacked. They're then loaded onto lorries, which carry them eventually to the pulp mill near Fort William on the mainland of Scotland. This forestry activity is out of the crofting tradition, as is the commercial manufacture of whiskey. On the Isle of Skye, there's one distillery at Talisker on the west coast. Malted barley is brought here from the mainland and milled. The resulting grist then goes into a huge copper mash tun where water is added to make liquid malt. Yeast is added after a further process, and fermentation takes place in six vast wash vats, each holding 35,000 litres. The blade rotates for 12 hours to stop overflow, then fermentation takes 48 hours. Distillation takes place in these stills. Regular checks are made by a customs and excise officer. The distilled whisky can only be put into barrels in the excise officer's presence, and he tests samples of the whisky to ensure that the contents conform to strict regulations. Although 60,000 proof litres of whisky a week are produced at this distillery, only 27 workers need to be employed. Finding employment for the islanders is a continuing problem. Over the last two centuries, thousands of Skye residents have left their crofts and emigrated to the mainland or much farther afield. Here, near Glen Brittle, we can see a small settlement still lived in near the mouth of the River Einot. And there, on the slopes nearby, we can see the lines showing the limits of many fields no longer worked. Scenes like this suggest decay and decline. But although the population of Skye has been reduced, the remaining islanders have kept alive the Gaelic language and local traditions. Like other Scottish islanders, the residents of Skye have seen considerable changes in their lives. This applies to their social and to their economic conditions. Depopulation continues, but the scenery and the traditional farming and fishing activities of the island attract many visitors. For Skye, the problem is keeping pace with change without losing its more permanent qualities.
The Land completes our school's programmes for today until 9:30 tomorrow morning. And lunchtime programmes on Anglia continue in a moment with Paperplay. Today, Susan Stranks will demonstrate how to make a puppet from a paper cup. And at 12:10, Hartley Hare and his friends will be back in Pipkins. At 12:30, there's more news from the Sullivans. Paul Cronin and Lorraine Bailey play the leading roles in the chronicle of an Australian family in the 1940s. The national news is at 1 o'clock, followed by the weather forecast and the Anglia news at 1:25. And then at 1:30, we have the last episode of the present series of Airport Chaplain. In today's story, a skilled engineer applies for a job as a cleaner, and his supervisor is so concerned that he consults the chaplain. Hello, good morning. Well, that's the way the programmes look this lunchtime, but now it's Paperplay.